Good morning, family. Good morning, family. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. My name is Ralph Charles, and for the first few minutes, I'm going to share a few reflections about John on behalf of myself and my NYPD family. It was in November of 2003 that I met John Mills. When I met him, I was a young kid. Believe it or not, I was actually younger than what I look now. And a lot of us know John to be a Knicks fan, like myself. A Jets fan, like myself. A Mets fan, one who loved his wife, Nita, one who loved his family. And there's many words we can describe how John is and how much he meant to us. But to me, John was an archer. And I know some of you may say, well, I know John, and he was not an archer. John carried a Glock 19, but he was not an archer. But to me, John was an archer. Because when you look at an archer has a bow and he has an arrow. The archer points the arrow in the direction where he wants the arrow to go. The archer also pulls back on the bow to send the arrow to his designated target. Now, what John meant to me was he was the one that pointed me in the right direction. And sometimes John pulled on me hard because he wanted me to go far. And sometimes he pulled on me with some tough words. Sometimes he pulled on me by leading by example. But I thank God for John because he pointed me in the right direction. He pulled me hard and I went far. So to you and to the family, to the friends, how can you honor John? You can honor him with his legacy, because I'm quite sure that he pulled on every one of you pretty hard. And I know he pulled on you harder because he wants you to go far. So if you have not yet reached that target that you intend to go, whether it's to get an education, whether it's to start a business, whether it be a family man, now is the time to go as far as John has pulled you. On behalf of my family from PSA 5, on behalf of Transit District 3, and the rest of us from the NYPD family, we are praying for you on the days and weeks to come. We know this is not a difficult time, but we know that the good Lord upstairs, he can hear your tears, he can hear your cry, and he's never too busy to answer your call. We love you, and we're praying for you. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Pastor Nate Demerstein. We welcome you here this morning to the homegoing service for John Mills, the lead pastor here at First Timothy Christian Church. It was our privilege to open the doors to the family, to have them here, and to have a chance. Please do not take this opportunity for granted. It was a little over a year ago when my mother passed away, and my father and my mother were the very founders of the sanctuary that you're here, but we were unable to use the facility in its full capacity as you have here today. As you very well know, we were limited to only 25 people, and my mother's gone. This opportunity you have here to meet, to greet, to hug, to touch, to see each and every person that has been touched by John's life is something priceless. Many people would pay for this and they couldn't. And so I want to ask you to solemnize it, appreciate it for what it is, and allow it to be a moment of healing for you, a moment of solace for you, and a moment that will mark your remembrance and the legacy of the life we're remembering. Quick announcements before I pass it over to the MC and director of service. We have exits behind you, exits out that way, and exits to my left, which is your right. Those are the three exits we'll be using to exit the building, with the exception of the immediate family and the casket. I'm going to repeat that again. We're going to be using those three exits. That exit runs to the gym and has a stairs. Most likely you'll use the front exit to 45, which is Route 45, Main Street, or you'll use the back exit to right here. Please try to maintain social distancing throughout the ceremony, throughout the building. Should there ever be a fire or fire alarm, remain calm. We'll have to exit the building accordingly and wait till the appropriate authorities. Our associate pastor, Pastor Yvonne's, is a member of the Hillcrest Fire Department right here, and he'll help direct you with any issues or situation that you may be in need of. We ask that as soon as we start the services, that you would limit the traveling throughout the sanctuary. So, and also, as soon as we start the services, that you would turn off all cell phones or place them on vibrate or silent for respect of the family and in respect of services. Matter of fact, if you would like to do so right now, you might forget, please put your cell phones on vibrate or silent. Those of you that have the watches that ring, put the watches on silent as well, and any other tech or technology for respect of the family. And finally, they will be making announcements to the funeral home with respect to where will we have the interment, pay attention to those, and a repast for the family as well. If you know anyone that would like to participate but could not be here, the service is being live streamed as we speak. The service is being live streamed. It is on the church's YouTube channel. Very easy. You don't necessarily need a link. It is FTCC, which stands for First Timothy Christian Church, FTCC space TV. FTCC TV on YouTube. There's only two links, Fayetteville Community College and our church. That's it. So it's FTCC TV on YouTube, and they can log on and they can participate while they are home or wherever they are along with us in the service. I do believe those are the only announcements. We're going to come to a close within the next 10 minutes of the viewing, and they're going to proceed to do what they have to do so we can send our brother away appropriately in the manner that he directly deserved and worked for in his life. Thank you. Thank you.
Test, test.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, church. Okay. If everyone would please find a seat. We have seats available to my left, to my right, and behind us in the balconies. It's a great view. If you wish to sit there, you're more than welcome. You can just follow the staircases on either side. We'd like to start our service. If the family of course would like to find their way to their seats. And everyone in the back, if you have a place to stand that you're not in someone else's view, or if you could find a seat, please do so. I'd like to ask for a round of applause for the angel of this church who opened his doors to us for this very, very important and special man, Pastor Nathaniel Demerstein. He's a man of the community, and whenever we ask him and tell him we need something, he always says, okay. He was touched by the honor of having John Fitzgerald Mills here today. And we thank him for his continued service in the community. Having said that, if everyone will remain silent, the officiant and pastors and elders will begin the service. Thank you. Thank you.
shall start the service with the invocation by Elder Aaron Kelly.
As we bow our heads and lift our hearts, what a friend we have in Jesus. All of our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pains we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning because you're our God. And beside you, there is no other. And without you, we would not be able to make it. So we say this morning, thank you. In spite of the pain, in spite of the hurt, in spite of the tragedies, in spite of the calamity and even the loss, we still find the place to tell you thank you, because your word says in all things, give thanks, for this is the will of the Father concerning us. God, we thank you because we know that you're with us. Even in this difficult time, you said you'd never leave us nor forsake us, but you would be with us until the very end. So it is the end for someone, yet the beginning for someone else, God, that we would become to know you in a way that is beyond our imagination, because you're here with us now, even in the pain. You're lifting us now. You're giving us comfort now. You're giving us peace now that surpasses our understanding. So even on this celebration of life, asking you to be here and be the great God that you are, and continue to lift Juanita, and continue to lift the children, and continue to lift his siblings, his family, his co-workers, his friends, those who have come from near and far, God. Continue to be our strength. Strength like no other. Continue to be our guide. Guide us through this time, God, that we don't understand. But God, I ask you most of all, continue to be our comfort. Comfort us today and the days ahead. And we're going to continue to give your name the praise. We're going to continue to give your name the praise. We're going to continue to give your name the glory. We're going to continue to give your name the honor. In Jesus' matchless name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
At this time, we will have an Old Testament reading, Psalm 90, from Aurora Jones. Amen. Scripture reading is coming from Psalms 90, verse 10 through 17. The days of our years are 80 years, and if by any reason of strength there be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away.
Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? And let it repent thee concerning thy servants. O, satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all of our days. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast afflicted us, and the years wherein we have seen evil. Let thy works appear unto thy servants, and thy glory unto their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands, establish thou it. Amen.
Testament reading, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 42 through 54 by Mariah Mills. Amen.
Of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable, it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, the last Adam, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth. The second man is of heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we all be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory.
Some comfort to know that at this point, this time, John is free.
Why do I feel discouraged? And why do the shadows come? Why do my heart feel lonely and long forever? sins, my comfort, a constant friend is He.
Let us receive him by saying amen.
Is the best thing I've ever done. Let's lift our hands in this place.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus is the best thing I've ever done.
Can you sing that with me today? Can you share that today?
Falling in love with Jesus.
that we are here with grief. I know that we are here taken by surprise. But that does not erase the glory that belongs to God. That was kind of weak. I want to hear you bless the Lord this morning. I want to hear you praise God in your pain. I want to see you give God what belongs to him, because he is still on the throne. He has not given up his position. The Lord is still standing here right now where we are. So I want you to stand on your feet. Give God glory. Give him praise. Acknowledge him in all of your ways. And know that God is still in control, regardless of your pain, regardless of your grief, because he is still loving. He is still caring. And he cares for you. He cares for me. Let's thank him today. Let's thank him today. Let's thank him today. Let's bless him today. Come on, pull it out of your soul. Pull it out of your spirit and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your goodness. With Jesus. Come on, fall in love all over again. Sing it with me. Falling in love. Falling in love with Jesus is the best thing I've ever done. Come on, give the Lord some praise in this place today. Come on and give him glory. Give him honor. Give him glory. Come on and thank him for being the loving God that he is. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I said hallelujah. God is still good, even on a bad day. I'm now approaching my 30th year of ministry, and one thing I found out of all the Bible promises that I have shared with people, sending them all the good things that are in the Bible. It's a lot of good things in God's Word. A lot of good promises for you and me. But there is one promise that I have always held on to. And that promise is from Jesus. And that promise says, in this life, you will have trouble, but take heart, because I have overcome the world. See, we always look for things to make us feel better, but sometimes feeling better is far from us. But we know that we have a comforter, we have a keeper, we have a lover of our soul that will stand with us in our deepest, darkest hour. We give glory and honor to the Most High God, to the Son, Jesus Christ, the presence of the Holy Spirit, the angel of this house, clergy, members, and friends. Thank you so much for receiving us today. This is not always easy, because I knew John. And one of the most blessed souls that you'll ever find. Blessed in his heart, always with a smile. And you knew that the room was better because he was there. And we thank God for his life and his legacy. And today, even though we're sad, we celebrate. Can you celebrate a life even when you're mourning the loss? That's my challenge to you today. Because life is so precious, we do not want it to leave sad. We want to thank God for the blessing of that life.
and thank God for the presence and the deposits that that life left upon you and I. The question is, are you better today because you knew John? Is there something John gave you that touched you? Obviously, something did because you're here. I could feel the heaviness in the room. But today, your burden can be lifted by remembering who John is, because that's what matters. I want you to go to the book of Matthew chapter 26, and then we will follow up with Psalm chapter 90. I'm not going to be much longer in front of you. In Matthew chapter 26, we're going to go to the 37th verse. This is the words that are recorded as Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. Many of us are familiar with that story. If you're not, this is prior to his crucifixion. This is the night before Jesus was to be crucified, to die. Jesus was in prayer with the Father. And I'm going to share the scripture with you, and I'll give you context. Verse 37 says, "And he took with him Peter and the sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, 'My soul is increasingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me.' He went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, 'Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will.'" The King James says, "Thy will be done." Psalm chapter 90, we're just going to lift one verse. You actually read it in the scripture reading for the Old Testament, and I will just take verse 12 from Psalm 90. It says, "So teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom." Today, I'm going to bring to you the title, "It's Time for a Hard Conversation." It's time for a hard conversation. What we see here is that Jesus was in the garden and he was dealing with meeting his destiny. What we need to understand is that when Jesus came, he came with a purpose and a mission. That mission was that he might be the sacrifice for our sins. The Bible says that there is no forgiveness of sins, there is no cleansing unless there be a perfect sacrifice. And Jesus is the only perfect sacrifice to carry your sins, my sins, upon him, that we might be in the presence of God. We'll talk about that at a later time. But as he was in the garden, throughout all of his years and time in ministry, in existence, he knew that he would die for our sins. But it's not until we get to the garden that we see Jesus getting the revelation of the process. Why is that important? Because it says that when Jesus got the revelation, basically, when he saw the manner or the amount of suffering he was going to have to go through, he actually asked the Father, "Is there another way?" Have you ever been in life willing to do something, but then you found out what you had to go through to finish the job? Have you ever been in life willing to go forward, but then you saw the bridges you had to cross? And then you asked the question, "Can we make this easier?" And this is what happens in the garden. Jesus was willing to die, but he looks and he sees, and now he gets the full view of the process that he's going to face the next day. My friends and family, I want to tell you something. Suffering is never convenient, nor is it something that we are always willing to go through. It rarely offers a solution that makes us feel better in the moment. Right now, Nita, this is suffering. This is suffering, and there's no way we can dress that up. There's no way we can make that better. We have to understand that we are going through the valley of the shadow of death. And when we understand that suffering is never convenient, and if we go into it with our eyes wide open, God will give us the mechanisms and the skills that we need to get on the other side. How many of you need to get on the other side today? If you realize that suffering is a part of life, and you accept that reality, then you match it with the Word of God. You read the Bible. Somebody say, read your Bible. Tell your neighbor, get the Bible app and read your Bible. See, the problem is that many of us don't know the Bible. We don't know what the Word of God says. So we're winging it. We're going through life winging it. And we're just going day by day by day with no understanding about the driver's manual. You jump in the car, you don't know how to change the oil, you don't even know how to turn on the radio because you have never read the life manual. And God has given us a life manual. And he told us how we can navigate this environment. The Word tells us and lets us know that man is fewer days and full of trouble. But God has given us a way around and a way through the process. Somebody say, get into the Word today. The reason why I'm telling you that is because there are beautiful things for you. There are beautiful things for your life if you understand that. Because we can even make sense of this circumstance. Why? Because when we looked at the scriptures and we saw this, and you must understand this, that the Bible gives us these guarantees. One, the Bible lets us know that God is with us. He is with us when you go through the fire. The Bible says when you go through the flood, whether it's water or whether it's fire, God will be there. The fire will not burn you, and the water will not drown you. That's what the Word says. The Word tells us that God is an ever-present help in the time of trouble. That means even when you don't feel him, he is there. See, many of us are looking for a sign. God says, and Jesus said, it's an evil generation that looks for a sign. You don't look for signs. You need to have faith. Somebody say, fix your faith today. Jesus said, have faith in God. If you have faith in God, there's nothing you will not be able to conquer. Because it is by faith that you please God. And it is the thing that God will give you every bit and ounce of strength you need to survive. You just need faith. You say, I need money. God says, no, you don't. You need faith. You said, I need to be healed. God says, no, you don't. You need faith. He keeps reiterating to you and me that you need to just trust him. Tell your neighbor, trust him. If you have trust in God, God can come through in your circumstance. And as we're sitting here trying to make sense of something that cannot be made sense of, we must default to the Word of God. Because even in that passage of Psalm 90, it says that man is given 70 years. We even look at Abraham. We look at Moses. And Moses lived to 120 years. Abram lived to 120 years. And the promise goes to 70 years. But then we later see that if it's purpose attached, there's no guarantees. Because God does not promise you any number of years, but God commands you to live out your purpose. See, Jesus lived to 33. But let me tell you something. It was a good 33. And that's the question I want to ask you today. What kind of life are you committed to? Because I want to say something to you today. I don't mean to offend, but maybe I'm lying because I don't mind offending. And let me tell you something. Some of us are playing too many games with God. We're playing too many games with God because we always think that tomorrow is promised. We don't live our life as if this is our last day. And John is here testifying to you and I. It's not about you living long. It's about you living strong. And my question to you is, how are you willing to live your life? And God has already told us that we must make a commitment to glorifying Him, because at the end of the day, that's the only thing that will matter. You say, I want a bigger house. God says, no, you need a bigger spirit. You say, I need more friends. And the Lord says, no, you need more angels. See, you must understand that how you translate life in this current vernacular and how you live this in this current existence, you must learn how to translate that to another existence, because this is not the end. Tell your neighbor, this is not the end. Your time on this life is short compared to eternity. Just because you don't see it, that don't mean it don't exist. And see, I am dealing in the modern age of secularism with those of us who do not believe that God is really God. Some of us right here, I'm sure you're listening to me now. You don't believe a hill of beans of what I'm saying to you. But I challenge you today, in your few years on this life, how much wisdom do you really possess? In your little time here compared to the history of the world, how much do you really know? And we must humble ourselves. Somebody say, humble yourself. You must humble yourself in the sight of God and understand that you have a purpose beyond what you think you're living out right now. John was a man who actually loved life. He loved his children. He loved his family. I always stayed at his house when I came. I could see it firsthand. It doesn't take much to understand what kind of person is when you see them in their natural habitat. And seeing the love and the fidelity that he had towards life and his family. He was in my amen corner on Facebook all the time, co-signing. And even though we were separated by distance, we were never apart in spirit. I'm saying this to you for a reason, because if you do not tap in to the reality of the spirit life God has for you, if you do not understand that Jesus has made a way for you to be close to God, does anybody here want to be close to God? No, seriously, does anybody here want to be? You know, I know we're talking spiritual, but the question is, do you want to be close to God? Because at the end of the day, it's going to be just you and him. And the Bible says that all of us will have to give an account for the deeds that we have done in this body. And you know what? You don't have to wait to go to heaven to know the Lord. It is great to wake up in the morning and say, "Good morning, Lord." It is great to walk and stand here before many of you strangers and know that the Holy Spirit is right here with me as I'm talking to you. The presence of God is real, and you must believe in that presence of God. And then, therefore, you're not going to spend the rest of your life worrying about are you going to live or die today. You just know you just want to be with him. Because whether John is in the body or out the body, he knows he's with the Lord. See, that's what the Bible says. It says whether I'm in the body or out the body, it doesn't matter, because if I live, I'm living for Christ. If I die, it's a gain, because now I can be face to face. But whether you live or die, whether you're here or not, you're in the Lord. Who wants to be just in the Lord? Just in the Lord. And the thing is that I'm not here to make you feel better. I'm here to jilt your consciousness. I'm here to shake you and tell you that God has a purpose that you must passionately fulfill. Some of us just don't have a passion. We don't have a passion in this life. But that can change today. Maybe this is the summons that God called you to. Because I can add no more chapters to John's life. The book is written. But what chapter are you on? And what redirects you need to put in your script? What reconciliations you need to make? What I'm sorries you need to get on the phone with as soon as we walk out this place? Come on and let's go out to lunches you need to make. This is not about John. This is about you. This is about me. We are all called here to be reminded of the shortness of life and the reasons that we live. Because when we strip back everything, you're going to realize that almost 80% of what you've been living for is worth nothing. The book of Ecclesiastes tells you that everything is vanity. All this stuff you're doing, you're just wasting energy, time and energy. And then you get upset. You get overly excited. You have all kinds of inappropriate reactions when God is trying to tell you, live for me. Because when you live for him, you will treat time a lot differently. To the last day, it was about his family. Isn't that a blessing? Is that not the blessing? To the last day, it was about his vows. To the last day, it's about his passion. See, because when you look at it in your own selfish way, which we all are, you'll say, oh, that was horrible. And then I said, wait a minute. Stop. Look at the testimony. Look at what is being told to us. To the last moment, it wasn't about foolishness. It wasn't about somebody that didn't matter. It was about the most
You know what we say these days? Keep the main thing, the main thing. It was about the main thing. Are you living for the main thing? Or are you just living? My prayer for you today is that you will tap into this grace, that you will find in your heart to live out the passion and the compassion that sets before you today. Let's look to the Lord. Father, we thank you for John. We thank you for your word. We ask today, Lord, as we stand here today, we ask and pray that you touch our hearts, that we might be able to apply our hearts to wisdom, that we do not waste our time, but we receive time as the blessing that it is given, and whether it be long or short, help us to use it to glorify you. This is our end. This is our praise for you. And we thank you in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Glory be to God. At this time, we will have a musical selection by the Reverend Jermaine Paul. Let us receive him by saying amen.
Message. What a message. Amen. I knew John on the sidelines watching the kids play ball. Good man. The best they come. Devout Jets fan. Walking in with his Jets jacket on. He had a way of talking about the Jets. He'd get so excited about the upcoming draft or who they gonna get. And the team's gonna get better. This is our year. But John believed. He had a sense of belief that would go past circumstance, that would go past what was in front of him. He had belief. Amen. Folks, it's time for us to believe. God is calling us to believe. Father, help your children. Don't let them fall by the side of the road. My heart.
truth in His word will be our salvation. So lift up your hearts and be thankful and glad, because Jesus is Lord. He won't let you down.
Acknowledgements, resolutions, cards, poems.
Good afternoon, family and friends. I have a few cards that have been shared with the family. In love and memory for the faithful, life is changed, not ended. With the sympathy of the Salesian brothers and priests at Don Bosco Prep, the holy sacrifice of the Mass will be offered for the repose of the soul of John Fitzgerald Mills. With deepest sympathy, may memories comfort you and bring you peace. To the Mills family, may God's love bring you comfort and peace during this difficult time. Love, Grisha family. And the loss of your husband. Dearest Nita, I believe in my heart of hearts that extra love and grace are being sent to you. I believe your husband's presence will be there to support you through the years to come in ways you cannot yet know. And I believe your amazing, loving heart will find a way to carry on and to smile again. So sorry for your loss. I hope you feel surrounded by much love. Win. To the entire Mills family, John, your dad, brother, uncle, granddad, friend, and son, etc. What an amazing person and what a remarkable life. I feel so lucky that I got to know him. My thoughts and prayers are with you all. To the family of John Fitzgerald Mills, we at Latter Rain World Outreach share in this moment of trial in the homegoing of your beloved husband, father, brother, and public servant, John. In a difficult time like this, man's words are never enough to bring comfort, but the word of God is more than able to meet your every need. And knowing this, we encourage you to draw off the words of Jesus to the Apostle Paul. My grace is sufficient for you, and my strength is made perfect in weakness. 2 Corinthians 12:9. So draw off his strength and power of the days ahead, knowing that he will guide you by the power of his hand. With eternal love, Daryl W. Elliott, Overseer of Latter Rain World Outreach. I've also been asked to read the obituary. John Fitzgerald Mills was born April 6, 1964 in New York City, New York, to Alma Wright and Jeremiah Mills, who preceded him in death. John graduated from Evander Childs High School in 1982. He began his work career at the Dime Savings Bank as a teller. John also worked at the Rockland Psychiatric Center as an orderly for 4 years. He then joined the New York City Housing Authority Police Department, where he met his beloved wife, Juanita. After the merger with NYPD, he rose to the rank, of sergeant in 2005. He then retired in 2010 after serving for 20 years from Transit District 3. John was a die-hard New York Mets and Jets fan, but he loved the New York Knicks. Basketball was his sport above all. He loved to smoke cigars and drink bourbon. He was known for being a movie commentator. He would always yell in the middle of the movie, saying what he would do or where people should go. That must be a Mills trait. He was also opinionated about many things, including local politics and the state of affairs in the U.S. John was the great debater. He would debate with anyone about any given subject. John was a history buff. John loved to spend time with his family. An ideal day for John was to have food on the grill and all the kids and grandkids in the yard playing while singing R&B classics. John was a mentor. His friends and family always sought him out for guidance and advice. John encouraged and influenced many people to live their best life. He also wanted his family to be well taken care of. John's mantra was, wrap it up, meaning that he was done and ready to move on. John leaves behind to cherish his loving and devoted wife of 26 years, Juanita Mills. His children, John Jr., Jamal Derrick, and Miles Jason, born from his previous union with Victoria Felder, Janelle Nicole, Jalen Christopher, and Tanasia Faith. His eldest brother, Jerry Mills of Baltimore, Maryland, and twin brothers, Eric and Derek Mills of the Bronx, New York. Grandchildren, Tyree, Mariah, Isaiah, Zaire, Xavier, Miles Jr., Nina, Kyler, Olivia, and Kaylee, as well as his beloved adopted children, Seth Grable, Kevin Major, and Nicole Felder. John transitioned from life and gained his wings in heaven on Saturday, March 8th, 2021. He was loved by all and will be greatly missed.
Day that the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. I don't know if protocol was established, but first giving honor to God who is the head of my life, to any pastors, ministers, bishops, elders, everyone in your respected places, I bring you greetings in the victorious name of Jesus Christ. You may not know me, but I consider myself family to Nick and Jordan, so I consider myself your family. So as I'm here today, I just want to encourage you to keep on, because we know that God has greater. Ecclesiastes says, to everything there is a time, and a time to every purpose. And it goes on to say, there's a time to weep, but then there's a time to laugh. There's a time to mourn, but then there's a time to dance. So as we're in the season as mourning, I pray that you find your time to laugh and you find your time to dance, because God, he knows what he has for you. Amen. So for every mountain he's brought us over, for every trial he's seen us through, so today we sing the highest praise, being hallelujah, for we know that God has us and he has you. God bless you.
I've got so much to thank God for. So many wonderful blessings and so many open doors. A brand new mercy along with each new day. That's why I praise you, and for this
want to encourage you. For every mountain the Lord will bring you over, and through this trial the Lord is sure to see you through.
Thank you for enabling us to gather here today so that we can celebrate a life well lived. We ask for the continued presence of the Holy Spirit in this place. Bring comfort to every one of us so that we can be able to mourn as believers. Holy Spirit, take full control and help us to do this unto Yahweh God and not unto ourselves. In Yeshua's name, even Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Giving honor to the Spirit of the Lord, to the elders here assembled, and to you and the family and friends, we say peace. Before he was a godfather, before he was a grandfather, before he was an uncle, before he was a father, before he was a husband, before he was an officer, he was first the youngest son to Jeremiah and Alma Mills, younger brother of Nick Mills, Eric Mills, and Derek Mills. And then at a very early age, he was my friend. I am so honored be here today. And like you, oh, how I wish I was not here. This has been on my mind for the last 2 weeks. I had a lot of thoughts about a lot of things. And I had thought about if it had happened when he was 67, it would still hurt. If it had happened when he was 77, it would still hurt. No matter when death comes, it is the great interrupter of life. Everything stops and has to be dealt with. It is painful, it is hurtful, and most times, because it has interrupted the flow of our continuity, it is very unbelievable. Faith is great, and it will sustain us. But the reality of this moment today is what tends to stay in your minds for some time. Yes, this is sad, but let us not forget that no one is guaranteed tomorrow. So while we are here, let us follow John's example and live life to the fullest. His life is celebrated by us being here today. I personally feel blessed because a friend of ours is very sick at the moment. And because of that friend's illness, John and I, for the last 2 months, talked about death, dying, and legacies. And I must tell you what he always told me, that he never feared death. He said when it is his time, he would be ready. 2 months ago, I thought I had lost him when he went in the hospital. I text Nita, and unbeknownst to me, she had fallen asleep and did not see my text until much later. And when I woke and had not heard back from Nita, I feared the worst. But at that time, it was a false alarm, and he was still here. And when he came home from the hospital, I told him how upset I was at the prospect of losing him. I said, I never experienced losing someone that I was so close to in my age group. But I realized, and I said to him, if we keep on living, people will check out. And that is the price one pays for living long. A lot of people will not make it with us. I got to tell him that he was the glue that holds everyone together. I told him you were a Super Bowl party, you are the cookout with the potato salad. I said you mean so much to everyone. But then I personalized it and I started crying. And I told him, I love you so much. You mean so much to me. And I got to say that while he was still here. He got choked up. He started crying. And after that, every time we spoke on the phone, we never took it for granted. I would always end it and say, I love you, brother. I love you. And he would say, he loved me back. John was love, and he is love, and is loved. He is the true definition of a friend, a person whom one knows and with whom one has a bond of mutual affection, someone you respect and who respects you, someone you trust and who trusts you. Him being honest makes you want to be honest. But more than all of that, John was loyal to you. When we were kids growing up, he was the kind of person that you always wanted on your team when you played a game. Even at a young age, he was mentoring and teaching. He had that kind of wisdom. He learned at a very early age the value of family from his mother, his father, and his brothers. There was no running the streets with us. Everything we did as kids was right there in front of 3643 Holland Avenue. John played a mean game of wiffle ball. He had a good arm. When we played football, touch football in the street, when we played strategy games, he was very strategic. And then, of course, on the hot days in the summer, we would open up the fire hydrant. There was no pool, and we were in the street. We had the tin can
with both ends out, and we sprayed each other. When we became teenagers and started our growth into pre-manhood training, we learned a lot about the world around us. His first job, actually, and some of his brothers in the summer of 81 was at the Sheraton Hotel in New Rochelle, which is now the Radisson Inn. The only time John ever punched me, and punched me hard, was the time that I talked him into going to work, and we walked from 3643 Holland Avenue in the Bronx all the way to New Rochelle. We worked as busboys, and I think that night we got about $4 each in tips. And as soon as the shift was over, he said, "Hold up, man, come here for a minute." Boom, punched me in the side. "I told you I was gonna hit you for making me walk all that way." And that's what we did. I think his political debating began because his father and his mother were very good at watching the news. We grew up with Bill Buttel, Roger Grimsby, Eyewitness News. And we talked about all those things. He learned how to cook at an early age. I could still see the big can of Crisco vegetable shortening in the kitchen. And that black skillet, John would season the chicken, and he'd put that big glob of vegetable shortening in the pan, and he would cook that chicken. But it was also, it was twofold. You had to cook and you had to clean. And so when it was John's turn to cook and clean, that meant one thing only. He would only cook and clean if he could play the Jackson 5 anthology. He would play Off the Wall and, of course, Thriller. Now, when it was Renee's turn to cook and clean, you listen to the Stevie Wonder anthology, and John would join in and would sing, but he would always break down each song and how they would sing and hit the notes and everything. And it was a marvelous experience. It was a great, great childhood. But then when we became in our early 20s, before he became a police officer, one of our all-time favorite things to do was bike ride. I lived in Mount Vernon, so this was before cell phones, so John would call me and he'd say, "Yo, I just got off from work. You wanna go riding?" I said, "Sure." He said, "All right, meet me at Gun Hill at 6:30. So I would ride my bike from Mount Vernon to the Bronx, and he'd be at Gun Hill Road, and he'd say, "Let's go." And I would ride the bike from Gun Hill, we'd ride to Webster Avenue, over the 3rd Avenue Bridge, down 3rd Avenue to 110th Street, into Central Park, and we would circle Central Park at least twice before we would take a break and then head back to the Bronx. Those were marvelous times. I cherished those moments because we bonded, and of course we were very skinny at that time. Extremely skinny. I used to tease him all the time. "Hey man, you wanna do some bike riding?" Well, I can't repeat from the pulpit what he said, but he was like, "No, man, those days are over." But he walked, we walked, but no more bike riding. He was the original gamer. He had ColecoVision, Nintendo, Atari, Genesis, PlayStation. He played for hours and mastered it. He mastered Kaboom, Burger Time, and then I would team up with him and we'd play Streets of Rage. And, you know, the hours would just go away. he never thought it robbery to take time to be there for you if you needed him. If he couldn't do it, he would tell you. But most times, he would give you the shirt off his back if you needed it. When my son was in junior high, I got a call from his grandmother that he was being disrespectful to her. So I asked my son if it was true, and of course, he to my surprise, he said, yeah, I said it. And I was shocked. So I got on the phone and I called John. I said, hey man, what day are you off from work? He said, Wednesday. I said, okay, I'm taking Wednesday off. We need to go upstate and we need to have a confrontation or we need to have a moment, you know, intervention. I said, we need to have an intervention. So he said, all right, we'll do it. And we went up there, and we went down in the basement, and when my son got home, his grandparents said, you have company. Company? He went down in the basement. He said, Dad? Uncle John? And John dressed him down. First time he ever yelled at my son. Broke him down. And he cried. But after he broke him down, he built him back up. He told him, hey, I see the potential. I see the good in you. You are more than this. He said, if I was your age, I didn't have these things. He said, if I was your age, I would have got knocked into the middle of the next week. And it broke him. And from that moment on, my son went on. It was the turning point in his life. He didn't become a statistic. And John was that way, not just with people he knew, he was that way with strangers. He told me when he was a transit cop, if he caught a kid hopping the train, he wasn't getting overtime. You got a lecture about you shouldn't do that and why you shouldn't do that. He didn't put the person into the system. He had that kind of love. He loved his family. He loved his family so much. I know one time me and Dwayne and him were talking about taking a man trip, and there was an opportunity, a political rally in D.C., and we went to D.C., and we said, okay, let's go. And we left on a Friday, and I think 3 hours in, he was like, man, I miss my family. I don't know if I should have came. We should go. I said, dude, we just got here. We haven't even eaten. And he spent more time on the phone calling everybody than he did with us. But that's who he was, you know. And the other thing was he always had, as anybody can test that knows the brothers, a wicked sense of humor. I remember John calling me to come pray for his father. His father was on his deathbed. And I go there to pray, and we're surrounded by the bed. And just before I gave the prayer, one of the brothers said, wait a minute, hold up, Jay. What do you have on? I said, I got on sandals. He said, them sandals look old, man. He said, Jay got on Air Moses. And we were all around the bed laughing. I mean, John and I talked about that lots of times. The point I'm making, he was a man who lived life and he enjoyed it. He was blessed and he always blessed others. When I was asked to do this, it was hard, but I had to. I had to avail myself as a friend. He and I go back to childhood. I mean, he actually now has taken with him some of my secrets. And when it's my time, I will take some of his secrets, because that's what real friends do. That's real love. And so I thought about quoting somebody or even a favorite Michael Jackson song, but I thought for this occasion, for this brother whom I love so much, I would take my chances and write a personal poem for him. So I'd like to share that and end with this poem. Few people get to have a people blessing. All of us here today are blessed because of you. Your life was our life. Your life is our life. You were the best son, the best brother, the best father, the loving husband, the best cousin, and the greatest friend. We take with us that portion of you that is near and dear to us. You were our co-chiefs in Cooley High, and it's so hard to say goodbye. But unlike co-chiefs who could have been the greatest, you became that with time. You could have been taken in the line of duty, but you were not. There are so many scenarios how this could have ended, but I'm so glad there was no long suffering when it did happen. So now, the time has come when it is your time now to join all those who have gone before us. You are going ahead of us here assembled today to honor you until the time of our own transitioning. Until we meet again, my memories of you will have to sustain me and us for now. May God watch over us while we're absent one from another. Thank you, black man. Thank you, my brother. I love you so much. At this time, we are going to have the benediction by Overseer Darrell Elliott. Then we will have the committal. After the committal, there will be a final viewing. The family and we have asked that when it is the final viewing, we would go from the last row to the first. You are asked to come up, view, exit the doors to the right. God bless. Thank you. My apologies, I was going ahead of myself. The brothers will speak before we do that. My apologies.
Stuff you talked about, you know, I taught him a whole lot of that, you know. Yeah. We still doing this thing. I want to thank all of y'all for, man, touched my heart. Everything you said, prayer, the word. Excellent. This is excellence right here. This is excellence. This is excellence, and he deserved that. So, I want to thank y'all for coming up from Baltimore. And that's my son on the drums. He had to be here for his uncle. Thank y'all for the music. As a matter of fact, before I say what I want to say, because y'all been talking about Michael Jackson, give me some mic, a little something. Y'all can play that while I'm talking. This dude right here, see, it's four of us, I'm the oldest. We got two Khan brothers. We got Eric and Derek, but you gotta love them. See, this right here. See, when I'm finished with this, then it's showtime. But I got the call, what was going on, because see, look, don't talk about our Jets and our Knicks and our Mets, you know, yo, I heard that. Every game, we texting back and forth. I'm in Baltimore, and then as soon as the game's over, we're talking. The night that he passed, I'm texting, I ain't getting no text back. What's going on here? Never happens. Then they're telling me what's going on, play by play, and I'm like, wow. But you know what? You were saying some things, and it comes from being grounded by our parents. Our mother and father taught us a whole lot. He took a lot of that, came to me, and he learned a lot from me. But then after he got older, he was like a little strong head. You couldn't really tell him nothing. Nita, y'all know, I can say that about him because you know that's my man. I love him. He loves me. And this is hurting me so bad to be up here. But you know what? When you're absent from the body, you're present with the Lord. And this dude right here, so we're going to take it to the sports analogy, because that's what we do. We talk about sports. So you know when you're ready to go to the Hall of Fame, and they say, like, some people you got to wait because, you know, they might wait four or five times before they can get there. And then they got some people, they say, you know what, he's a shoe-in. He's present with the Lord, and I know that. He knew the Lord. He didn't go to church all the time and everything, but we would talk about scriptures, and he knew the Lord. If you start talking like she said, he's a debater, he'll get into the word with you, and he knew what he was talking about. If you're talking about politics, he knows what he's talking about. He can teach you something. He did his homework with that. He was definitely a good cop. We always talked about stories and things that he did, you know. But most of all, he was a family man. Anytime we come up from where we are, we stand at his house. He'd be like, you ain't going nowhere. You're going to be right here. Okay, I'll go stay with them a couple of days, but you're going to be right here. No. All the people that he's touched, y'all have no idea. All these little young men right here on this front row, those ain't his kids, but those are his kids. He's instilled things in them, and I saw it. And then he'll bring me to him, and I'll talk to him. No, because it takes a village. We strong believer in that. And he definitely was every bit of that. You know, so there's something else I want to say, though. Because a lot of us are hurting, and we see that he's not here. And it was all of a sudden. Like, when my parents passed, we expected that. So that was, like, not as crushing. Because we were preparing for that. We weren't prepared for this. But see, that's the thing that I really want to talk about. Because all that I can give him, all his accolades and everything, and that's good for those that know him and those that don't. But
see him being taken away early, we always got to know that it's a lesson in everything. It's a lesson in everything. So what I'm saying to you is this. The relationship that I have with my brother, my brothers, we can argue and talk, whatever, whatever, but you ain't going to never see us not talking to each other every day or whatever. And there's some people out there that don't even speak to their family members. You understand what I'm saying? So he's telling you right now, get it right. Get it right. We all know who you are. I know a couple of you right now that ain't, don't even want to talk to your mother and your sisters and brothers. And I'm like, I don't even know how to do that. We don't know how to do that at all. The other thing is, you don't know when your time is coming, so you need to get with God. See, he was saved, so I know where he is. But the only way you can do it is through Christ. That's the only way you can keep living after this, because this right here is short-lived. Yo, Derek, what did he say to you the last time you talked to him about your days, the shorter day? What did he say?
He said, "Our yesterday is more than our tomorrow."
Absolutely. Absolutely, what he said to him. Yeah, I don't want. You know how many people I know that when it was over, they coming to me crying, talking about like, yo, man, I didn't even get a chance. I was getting ready. It's time to get it right now. Get it right with the loved ones. Get it right with the people that you think you got problems with. But first, get it right with God. Because then he's going to correct all that, and he will have you where you need to be. So my brother, I love you and I'm going to miss you, but I know you're in a better place. You're definitely in a better place. And to my nephews, my sister-in-law, yo, I'm here. It's crazy, but I ain't really want to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. I'm the oldest one left. I'm going to meet you out now. I'm the oldest one out of all the brothers. Mom, pop's gone. No. But what I do know is this. Regardless of what goes on, I'm a phone call away. I'm right there. And everything that my mom and pop taught us about family, being together, and the legacy that's going on. So that kind of stuff that's going on here, that he instilled in each and every one of y'all, next man up, John. Next man up. The way I'm with my brothers, that's the way you're going to be with them. It's already there. I already know because he taught you well. And all of y'all doing the right thing. Ain't nobody been no trouble because you know what your upbringing was, what it is. And I need you to continue that. And he's going to be looking and understand all that. So I thank each and every one of y'all for coming out here. I thank y'all for showing them the love. I appreciate each and every one of y'all. And you know what? He still lives. He's not here on earth, but he still lives. He lives in your heart. He lives in each and every one of your hearts, you know. And his spirit is. Man, if for those of you that are here that know him, I know each and every one of y'all have a different relationship with him because he's the way he is, you know. But for those that don't know him, just looking at the room is a testament to who he was. And I appreciate that. I want to say this again because, like, this whole service right here, it was excellence. Erica, thank you for that song. I needed that so much. That was real. Each and every one of y'all that got up here and sung today, that was a real part of me, and I appreciate that. You know, I'm not going to hold the mic long because I know we got to keep it moving, but what you talking about, that shiny ring over there? What you trying to say? I'm going to shut it down, but I love each and every one of y'all. Thank y'all for coming out. Before we leave, I want to, within order, just to offer to you the opportunity to reconcile your relationship with God. So before we dismiss, I would ask you all, if it touched your heart today, the Holy Spirit knocking on the door of your heart, you wish to give your life to Christ. You wish to rededicate your life, reconcile your relationship with God. Because if we do not do that, much of what we have done will have been in vain. And we don't want to leave that way. So I do extend to you the offer and the invitation to give yourself back to God through the salvation provided by Jesus Christ. He is our Savior and He is our keeper. So within order today, I will not ask you to walk the aisle, but I will ask you to bow your head. Everyone here, bowing your head and examine your heart and ask yourself, am I where I should be in my relationship with God? If not, talk to Him right now. He's right here and He's listening to your prayers. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I confess my sins, and I ask that you wash me of my sins. Be my Savior, be my Lord. And I wish to live for you. Today is the first day of the rest of my life and the best days. Come into my heart, renew me, fill me up again. Let me see my purpose, and I will live it out to your glory. If that is you, congratulations. Congratulations, if that's you today. And when we leave here, tell somebody. When we walk out the back, tell somebody. You know that prayer he told me to pray? That was me. I prayed that. And I'm trusting God for the rest of my life. Tell somebody and seal your decision. Amen. So if we will, let us all prepare to be dismissed, and then we'll have the committal. So let's bow our heads as we look to the Lord. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to celebrate the life of our dear brother John. Lord, we thank you for the grace that you have blessed him with. Thank you for his family as a testimony to his existence.
Thank you for the words of love and kindness that he has blessed us with. Thank you for the deposit of wisdom and of camaraderie and being a good father, brother, partner, son, husband, all of his roles that he has fulfilled in life. And Lord, we do not take it lightly of your blessings. Now help us to reflect this moment with living out in grace and in glory. Now may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. To him be glory and majesty, now and forever. Be glorified in the church and in your life. In the matchless name of Jesus, we all say amen.
Shown to them during your time of bereavement. May God bless and keep you. Special thanks. Sorry, my eyes. Special thanks to Mrs. Brenda Logan Charles, Miss Keisha Williams, Miss Robin, Mrs. Robin Ham. Mrs. Keisha Williams, I'm sorry. We want to thank the First Timothy Church, Spring Valley, Reverend Nathaniel Deshazir, I'm sorry for mispronouncing that, Assistant Pastor Yvonne Lewis, the Town and Country Cedars Congregation of New York. And we'd like to thank Wanamaker and Carlo Funeral Home, 177 South Route 59, Suffern, New York, and Mr. Desmond Martin. Thank you. Prayer of committal. Father, hear our prayers for your servant. We ask that you receive our loved one into your kingdom to experience joyful fellowship with the saints that have gone on before. Truly, this earth is not our home. We are just passing through. We look forward to our eternal home where all tears are wiped away and sorrow and death are no more. We look forward to being reunited with our loved one. We watch and wait for that blessed day filled with your goodness and lost in your love. Because God has chosen to call our brother John Fitzgerald Mills from this life to himself, we commit his body to its final resting place, for we are dust, and unto dust we shall return. So let us commend our brother to the Lord, and the Lord may embrace him in peace and raise up his body on the last day. Amen. As I said earlier, we will have the final viewing. We ask that people will come from the back to the front and exit to the right. Thank you. remember, the repast will be at the Town and Country Caterers in Congers, New York. Thank you. Thank you.
evening, everyone. We asking that everybody please exit the building. We just need just the family here. Could you please give the family their last respect? Could everybody please quietly exit the building? Thank you so much.